So, this is a presentation about the case of a German pilot who died in American Virgin. So now we've got a German pilot. It's Rothschild, German German, who apparently deliberately crashed his plane into the Alps.
Yeah.
Okay? And when I first come across this, then as reported in the media, I thought it was a little bit bizarre. He was 27 years old, which I thought was quite a bit young to be a co-pilot on an Airbus 320.
Yeah.
And the whole thing did not make sense as it was presented in the media, because it was presented as a suicide. And I'm going to try to see, to show that it was not a suicide, actually. So, Angela Lubitz was his name, 27 years old. He grew up dreaming of flying and of one day becoming a pilot. So he had, it seems, an ideal in place.
Okay.
And apparently he had a hidden, unspecified medical condition which he hid from his employers. The rumor, and that's only a rumor, was he was being bipolar. I have no bipolar. I have no confirmation of that. He had been in the past treated for suicidal tendencies, and he may have been suffering from a loss in eyesight. If that loss had been severe, then he would have lost his job as a co-pilot. Father, successful business executive, and mother was a piano teacher. And he had been a pilot since 2013, and before that he worked as a cabin crew for Lufthansa. And perhaps here we have a little bit of the effects of a capitalist discourse. Because 27, a pilot, a co-pilot at 27 is something very special, very specific. So he was working for an air company called German Wings, a subsidiary of Lufthansa. Perhaps piloting on the cheap was what that air company was after by promoting him to co-pilot age 27. So again, possibly an effect of the capitalist discourse. But I think it's, if there is that effect, it's entirely separate from what actually happened.
Yeah.
Remember, he, according to the black box, which records all the flight information, he deliberately started the descent when the boat Alps and crashed the plane.
Yeah.
With 160 people on board. By the time of the accident, he was relatively inexperienced. He had 630 hours under his belt as a co-pilot, whereas the pilot had 6,000 hours.
Yeah.
This is a huge difference, and a huge difference also in experience.
Yeah.
This is why I'm saying possibly we have an effect of a capitalist, of a discourse of a capitalist. It was said about him that he was not particularly a gregarious man, so he didn't seek company, but that there was nothing out of the ordinary about him.
Mm.
That's often said, by the way, about people in a perverse position. The pedophile, for instance, is very, very ordinary looking. He doesn't advertised that he's a pedophile, he dresses absolutely normally, he's one of your neighbors, he's one of us. Yeah. So that's worth keeping in mind. And the judge in charge of this inquest said that there was a deliberate desire, and I'm quoting here, a deliberate desire to destroy this plane. He refused to open the door of the cockpit to the pilot, and then began the descent of the plane. What happened was that you have two people flying that plane.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I'm bringing back the discourse of the capitalists here, because in the old days, flying planes, big planes, you have the pilot, the co-pilot, and the flight engineer, three people. When fly-by-wire, as it's called, was introduced with lots of electronics, bang goes the flight engineer. So you've only got, if that's an economy on salary,
yeah.
training,
yeah.
insurance, and you've only got two people left.
Cool.
So now the airlines are scrambling around to find a way for this kind of incident not to happen again. What happened was that the pilot went to the toilet, so got out of the flight cockpit, and the co-pilot, that German guy, was left on his own. When the pilot came back, he was trying to get in, but the door was locked. So he locked out the pilot deliberately.
Yeah.
And there was no way, apparently, for the pilot to regain entry. So the co-pilot, this German guy, Andreas Lubitz, was in charge on his own. Yeah. This is why I'm bringing a little bit of the discourse like that today. There's something which I thought was lacking in the media, which was what I call the metaphysical background to German culture.
Okay.
Also known, obviously, as the symbolic background of German culture.
Yeah.
And we're going to try to look at all of that from the point of view of the superego,
yeah.
and that's Freud's second topography, id, superego, and ego.
Okay.
And the notion of ich ideal and ideal ich. Germany has been, was for a very long time, a divided country. It did its unity in 1870 on the back of the French, after having won what was called the Franco-Prussian War. And it was led by Bismarck. Before, it was just a collection of little towns. This is why Bismarck came up with this thing, Deutschland über alles, Germany above everybody else. But that everybody else did not mean the rest of the world, but above all the little principalities, let's try to form a coherent ensemble. Then there was the occupation of the Ruhr after, by the French after the second, First World War to force Germany to repay its war debt. There were was very unstable politics in immediately after the First World War, the Weimar Republic, for instance,
yeah.
and its collapse. Then there was a division during immediately after the Second World War. Half of Germany was given over to the Soviets,
mm-hmm.
and it only did its reunification from 1988.
Yeah.
So we have this particular background. Remember also that area. In between the 9th and the 12th century, sorry, prior to the 9th century, had been conquered by the Vikings. And Germany only became Christian between 9th and 12th century. So you have a background of the Norse, Nordic mythologies.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's still there.
Yeah.
In that background, there is this concept, this category of Ragnarok. And that's the Nordic, Norse word, Ragnarok. Right. Ragnarok, which means the doom of gods. And in its popular version, you have the end of the world. That's it, it finishes, it's over, and there is nothing else afterwards, no redemption, nothing. Okay, so we are in presence of an absolute there. And you can find that in Wagner's opera Der Himmel der Blumen, especially in the last act, Die Götter Dämmerung, which means the twilight of the gods. And what happens on stage is the gods are in their palace called Valhalla. It catches fire. The entire building burns down. Everybody dies. And that's it. Absolute end. That's the end of the opera. Yeah, so we've got that there. So, obviously this passion of a plane is not exactly like the Japanese kamikaze during the Second World War.
Mm-hmm.
The kamikaze were anchored, had a link with the symbolic, because they crashed their planes into American destroyers in order to save the emperor and to save their country. So you have signification, a symbolic signification there. We have another background here, Mr. Goethe, German poet, as famous in Germany as Shakespeare is here. Yeah. Every schoolboy in Germany knows about Goethe. 1749-1832. And he became very famous suddenly at the age of 24 from a book he'd written called The Sorrows of Young Werther, also known as Werther.
Yes.
Okay? First bestseller. Everybody wrote it. And that book described a story, a kind of triangular love affair. We got Werther, his best friend Albert, and Charlotte. The two are in love with Charlotte. It's just that Charlotte prefers Albert. Mm-hmm. So Mr. Werther, young Werther, finds himself in a position of what I call want too much. His solution is to remove himself from that want too much. And how does he do that? He borrows his best friend pistols and goes boom. Mm-hmm. That's a book. At the time, it was scandalous.
Yeah.
We are still in a Christian country. Suicide is an absolute no-no. God gave you life, only God can take it back. Yeah. In those days, if you were suiciding, you would not get buried in consecrated grounds, which means you would get your body back on resurrection day. So to actually produce a piece of fiction, even though it's all fiction, to produce that in those days was absolutely scandalous and that was part of his success. But moreover, Goethe told us, we know that very precisely, he told us that was his way of coping with a similar situation happening in his real life. He had a huge love disappointment. And his way of coping with that, of keeping the knot together, was to create this piece of fiction.
Yeah.
Not only that, this is where it becomes interesting. After the book was published, people who read it, and let go, boom. There was an epidemic of suicides in this particular part of Germany.
Yeah.
Absolute. Yeah. And again, against the tenets of their religion of Christianity.
Okay.
Read Werther, and then boom. That's true, that's very well documented.
So it's subversive. It's subversive of the regulations, legislation in place.
It's not so much, it has an effect of subversivity, but there is a push which is stronger.
Yes, it goes through those regulations.
Those regulations are not holding people, we're not holding people in place any longer.
Because once they read the book.
Once they read the book.
Yeah.
So I think we have here historical identification. We have an identification of some kind, and I would say historical identification.
Okay.
You know about historical identification?
Seems logical. Dora, that's
Dora's cough.
There's Dora's cough, for instance, and another example given by Freud in group psychology in the ego. In a boarding school for young girls, one girl receives a letter and she's been dumped by her lover, and she starts crying and being in all kinds of states, and everybody else gets in that kind of state, irrespective of the suffering they will go through.
Yeah.
This is what I'm saying, we have possibly in that Werther issue, everybody going boom. And again, in those days, it was not an automatic clean pistol. You had these one-shot pistols which you had to load, and then you had to put powder in, you had to compress it. So, in a way, you had time to think, but no. Mm. And you went boom. So, let's go now to the pilot directly, and let's go into Freud's second topography. First topography was conscious, preconscious, and conscious. The second topography from 1921 is id, ego, and superego. Okay? Mm-hmm. Superego is both good and bad. It's a moral agency.
Yeah.
Okay? And two parts to this, to that superego. So you've got the id pushing, wanting something.
Yeah.
And the superego who says yes or no. When the superego says no, there's the ego which is trying to serve two masters at the same time, that's the correct expression.
Mm-hmm.
So it produces a compromise which is going to satisfy both demands of those two. That compromise is the symptom.
Yeah.
Okay. But I don't think we're there in that dimension at all in that German pilot. We do have superego functioning.
Yeah.
And we'll try to see what actually, what possibly to play. So this superego has got two parts. One is called the ideal, which I translate as the ego ideal, and which I transpose as the ego's genitive ideals,
yeah.
i.e. the ego's S ones, your personal S ones. I.e. I want to be like so and so and become a very famous pianist or a very famous teacher and so on and so on. Yeah. So they are very, very useful S1s to have in place. It's what I call them personal S1s. And that moves you from the position of to have to the position of wanting to be like. You know, with your children, they see your little children, right? They see something on the table, they want to have. They don't want to be like you and do the necessary negotiations in order to get that thing. They're here for it. That's pre-Oedipus. Yeah. And there's another part to the superego called the ideal ich. Ideal ego, big S1s. It's the one, and I'm putting question mark as to whether there is only one S1 or several. They are master signifiers, basically. And ideal ich is the one who says, bah, you've been bad. It's the one who says, no, you can't have an extra piece of chocolates. No, you can't afford to buy this new pair of trainers. Yeah. And Freud said it's phylogenetic. It's a kind of condensation of all the parental words, speech, verbal speech. This is why in cases of paranoia you've got these impersonal sentences coming out being heard by the subject.
Sorry, in the case of
paranoia. You hear voices, and those voices speak about you in the third person.
Yes.
Well, that's parents' voice, basically, yeah? Trace memories of parents' voices. Yeah? So, that's all.
Yeah.
Now, this is not transcendental. It's not above in the air somewhere. It's right in there. It's in us. And it's art. That's a very important point here. And the effect of instinctual renunciation on the conscience then is about every piece of aggression whose satisfaction the subject gives up and is taken over by the superego and increases aggressiveness. Because Mr. Superego has a very, very specific and very bizarre way of functioning. Mr. Superego watches what you're thinking, consciously, two, what you're thinking unconsciously, and three, what you intend to think or intend to do but have not done.
Bully.
Yeah, absolutely. Mr. Superego makes no difference between those three things. You've got bad thoughts, you will, whether you've acted upon them. down on you like a ton of brick.
But he, the superego watches.
It
That's
always
important.
Watches.
He's always watching.
Yeah, it's always watching. This is why also in case of paranoia, schizophrenia, you have this, I'm being watched.
Yeah.
God is watching me. There are cameras, surveillance cameras, especially put in to watch me. And note the reference to this me, they are watching me.
Yeah.
It's never they are watching somebody else, my friends, the local newspaper agent. No, they're watching me. That's very important point here. Yeah. So, and the way it has to, it reacts to your bad thoughts is to disarm them by taking the libido away from those thoughts. Remember, memory traces are inscribed in the quota of the libido. Takes the libido away.
Yeah.
And gets it into itself. As it becomes more powerful with libido, it watches you even more. So it finds, eventually it finds the latest little trace of bad thoughts. So it's a kind of vicious circle. It becomes very powerful and then it absorbs all the libido. Hence, me, 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 me. Watches me, they're watching me, they're recording me, etc. Yeah. Superego basically takes all the video for itself. So we have kind of inbuilt severity in this superego, but then Freud says actually this severity, this aggressiveness of the superego is your own aggressiveness which you had as a child towards your parent. That's how the ground is prepared for the superego to be able to pump all that libido for itself. So, damned if you do, damned if you don't. Now, you can understand why the attitude of very self-righteous people.
Yeah.
Who are always saying, no, 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 you must not sin, etc. So we're being very self-righteous in their attitude. Well, that's the superego, basically, taking over with all the aggressiveness, except the aggressiveness in most cases has been repressed. Okay. So no self-righteousness without aggressiveness and conscious aggressiveness. Yeah?
How can you assert yourself over the superego?
You do not, you can't. Once it starts pumping all the libido, that's it. Damned if you do, damned if you don't. We all have, all of us have some kind of moralistic Victorian aspect to our character. Okay. Now, in the case of our pilots, what I'm proposing is that he withdrew all his libido 100% from the world.
How do you know that? Oh, sorry.
It's my hypothesis.
Oh, it's your hypothesis. Okay.
It's a very...
I immediately want to get it. Okay, I'll go with it as a
it's
hypothesis.
A very, of course, it's only a hypothesis because I didn't know the chap.
Yeah.
I haven't got his biography as a book and he's dead anyway. So my hypothesis was there was a push and a pull. And Freud is very insistent on that particular movement. Push from somewhere as well as a pull from somewhere else. So I'm saying all his libido was there in the superego, and that was the push. And the pull is most components of German culture. Absolute. Nothing left, end of the world, end of the universe. Nothing. Afterwards.
So they're absolute acts.
Absolute.
And they're in a vacuum, and there's no right nor wrong, they just are. Yeah.
And in the case of Gert, that's also an absolute. Of Gert committing suicide, going boom.
Yeah, there is no other way out.
Yeah. He could have immigrated to another country, find himself a nice lady, or whatever. No, he goes for the absolute. Yeah. Yeah. And it's a very, very well-known book in German culture.
Yeah.
As well-known as your Shakespeare plays here. Okay. And yeah. Every schoolboy, schoolgirl in Germany has gone through Goethe.
Yeah.
Goethe, by the way, died of natural circumstances in his old age.
Yeah.
So, there is no big other into whom he could have grounded his excess of jouissance. So his only solution was to swallow it and to make it part of the superego. And in that sense, he became detached from the totem, i.e. from the social bond. He was in his own little sphere. No separation from Das Ding. Yeah? Mm. So, he didn't produce, he didn't have an object A. He did not go over to a father. No name of a father. And in that sense, not in that sense, but in actuality, his unconscious had direct access to the muscular apparatus. Back to Freud's interpretation of dreams, when you sleep, access from the unconscious to the muscular apparatus is cut off.
Okay.
Whereas in waking life, the unconscious has access to the muscular apparatus.
Yeah.
And you can produce either acting outs or passage to the acts, Dora asleep.
Yeah.
If Dora had been asleep, she wouldn't have been to actually start people. It's not always true that during sleep the unconscious does not have access to the muscular apparatus, because we've got somnambulism, people waking up sitting on the roofs of their houses. Yeah? Okay. No sublimation, because it doesn't have object A, then no access to sublimation. Could have sublimated his issues, his problems with his eyesight into something else, I don't know, but there was no access anyway. Yeah? And therefore he didn't have any illusions as in the sense of Freud's text, the future of an illusion.
I want to read that.
Yeah, it's a very interesting thing. So he's not a dupe of a sans-mort, and because he's not a dupe, les non-dupes errent. If he's a non-dupe, he's lost. You have to at some point accept to be the dupe of a semblant, to accept the semblant as a semblant, and he's invited. Yeah. So he's completely in the real. He's operated on by the real. And he's well, well beyond anything. He's a kind of absolute. He's more God than God. That's why he can go and cross his leg. So, in a way, he also has reverted to the logic of to have instead of the logic of to be like. And therefore, he has no access to identification. He could not perhaps become a pilot instructor. He doesn't need to have full eyesight for that. He could have started some kind of business, a computer game, for instance, based on piloting, his experience of piloting. No, he went for the absolute. I'm saying there was, as the pull, push from superego, which has absorbed all the below, and then pull from this metaphysical background. Okay? And can say there is a perfect fit, in this case, a perfect fit, perfect coincidence between demand and desire. Usually, from demand to desire, you get your desire, but it's not quite that, so you keep looking for something else which you think is going to make to be adequate for your demand, to your demand. And that's what propels us, allows us to reach sublimation.
So and we're always failing in demand.
we always failing, so we keep going back to produce something more.
But demand is a form of desire.
Demand is on the left hand side of the graph, desire is on the right hand side.
Oh, okay. Yeah? Okay.
This keeps oscillating. Sometimes we find what we want, sometimes we don't. But even if we find something that we want, well, it's not quite that because you have a movement of libido breaking this and then this becomes this.
Yeah.
So in his case, he was beyond that, or he was stuck there.
So where was the demand? What was the demand?
Well, he was beyond that, actually.
You said there was a perfect fit.
Yeah, there was a perfect fit between demand and desire, which puts him beyond demand and beyond desire, which means he was in a kind of tête-à-tête with Dustin. Him and Dustin.
Yeah.
That's it.
So why was he beyond the passage to the act?
I didn't say that.
Ah, so is he within the passage to the act?
He was constantly in the passage to the act. He was constantly driven from the superior.
Yes.
And that side of the superior, not this one. This one is what you want to be like when you grow. Yeah. This one is a
driver.
All encompassing.
Yeah.
It's very good.
So that's imaginary.
Yeah, that's real.
That's real, yeah. Okay. But that's symbolic.
This one is symbolic, yes.
Yeah. So it's symbolic and real.
And this one is real. Or this is the father of the collective whole. And because he's not anchored in the social bond, there's nobody else, there's nobody to challenge him or kill him, like the father of the collective whole. He's constantly in that position. His demand is fully satisfied, so he doesn't need to go on the road to maintaining him or metaphor. He's stuck in this one place. He's a superior. He's become a superior. He's an incarnation in the flesh of a superior 24/7.
And it would be difficult to see. You could be perfectly normal, be the incarnation of a super ego, because you have a way of touching the world.
So was he carrying this as an intention before it happened? Because we can't know the trigger to the passage to the act. So what was the decision that led him to crash that particular
thing? I don't know. On that particular day, I don't know. Apparently he had been researching, crashing, descents, all that. Flying aspects, technical flying aspects, descents and so on.
And there was something about the trip before that plane made that he was on, that he did some kind of experimental, he did a tryout or something, that people realised in retrospect.
In retrospect, yes. This is what we are also doing in retrospect, trying to create some significations, sense out of it. And of course we end up creating meaning.
Yeah.
Okay. Because this is imaginary. Huh?
Yeah. The tube that would, if the mortgage tube crash, the driver had been practicing, if you like, overrunning the stop sign for some time before he actually crashed it into the wall.
That's interesting, this rehearsal.
The rehearsal aspect is interesting.
It's a kind of transit, isn't it?
It's an attempt at perfection so that this does not oscillate any longer.
It just stops oscillating.
Yeah. Suicide is the only act which succeeds.
Yeah.
It's like,
so the desire for success led to the intent and the preparation.
As driven by superego.
So it would have satisfied his superego, is that
absolutely
what you're saying?
Yeah.
But I don't quite understand how it would have satisfied his superego, because the superego had just consumed so much libido and wanted such perfection.
The more it consumes libido,
yeah,
the more it consumes libido. It's a kind of vicious circle. Yeah. And ego is actually entraîné, is dragged in that whole thing. And then you've got a triumphant ego, which is exactly how you could describe man's little death. For a little moment, there is a coincidence, a fit between demand and desire, this cutoff point, except it lasts. Doesn't last forever, but so in this case, it was triumphant ego, dragged by superego.
So the ego and the superego are working together.
They, and there is no relationship any longer. They all coincide and become.
That's what I'm trying to say. There's no relationship between them.
Yeah. They become one.
Yeah, they become one.
That's my hypothesis. And again, this has no relationship to the suicide bombers of the Japanese kamikaze.
No relationship.
It's an entirely different phenomenon.
Okay.
The kamikaze, that was for the emperor for Japan. The suicide bombers, that was for their cause.
He was possessed.
Yeah, you could say that.
You know, because all he did was, you know,
aim
his plane towards the earth, and even his breathing.
Apparently, he continued breathing, but
quite normally, no anticipation. So it's almost like he was absent.
Yeah. There was something absent because you've got the fusing of these three things.
Now, since we are fusing on this side, actually we also have diffusing on the other side. If we go back to Eros and Thanatos, no Eros without a little bit of Thanatos.
Yeah.
It is from being mortal that we reproduce and our production is saturated. Well, it used to be not so any longer, it's no longer exclusively saturated, well, to some extent. And no Thanatos without a little bit of Eros. So normally they are entwined together.
Yeah.
In this case, there was a complete diffusion, and that can happen. Process, it can happen.
Complete diffusion,
yeah. And Thanatos flies off on its own. That's another way to look at it.
Yeah.
The diffusion of the drives of Eros and Thanatos. And Thanatos takes off.
Yeah.
So, he went into the absolute, that absolute of which there is a background in German culture.
Yeah.
The Ragnarok is absolute, suicide
is absolute. But not everybody takes it as absolute. He took it as absolute. He took it as the only thing one does.
When you lose your eyesight and you're a co-pilot.
Yeah.
So that's my presentation there. It's phenomenal. And of course, in all the media reports, there was no mention of the German cultural background.
Did it take a lot of research to find out about Ragnarok?
No. I knew about all that.
I knew about Goethe. Yeah.
That book of Goethe is what launched his career. It made him famous. It was the first bestseller. It sold like hundreds of albums.
Yeah. But I really had no idea about the Viking connection and all that mythology.
All that area of Northern Europe,
yeah,
yes, had been invaded by the Vikings. Sweden, Norway, Denmark, Germany.
Yeah.
So they brought with them, obviously, or their mythologies and cosmogonies.
So he was already dead to the world.
He'd never been castrated. He'd never suffered loss.
No separation from this deal.
But how could he have made such a good semblance of being normal, you know, like people reported that he was...
That's the thing. As I said earlier on, people in perverse positions or pedophile, they look absolutely normal. There is nothing which will distinguish them from other people.
So
that's the thing. They are normal.
They mimic.
No, the game for them, the interesting part for them is the whole game of looking normal and trying to infiltrate themselves in certain situations. The prize in the case of a pedophile, for instance, the prize is the cherry on the cake, it's not what they're after. What they're after is deception.
But presumably this guy wasn't aware of that game that he was.
He wasn't aware of anything.
And you drew him from there, yeah.
But he'd been well trained by a very German mother.
Really?
Well, it looks
pianist. She was a pianist. She was an artist.
Artist. She trained him well.
Full of ideals.
No, precisely. There was no ideals there. There's no identification.
Full of rules and regulations, and imposing them directly, but never giving the reason.
Never thinking about the ideal ego, you know, the big ex.
Yeah. Putting a question mark as to whether there is one big S1 or several. This is your moral conscience.
It's your moral conscience.
That's what it says, bad. Freud says...
He's got no way of putting his mother's words in that situation above the question.
Freud says the superego rains down
on
the ego.
And for whatever reason, it seems that his father couldn't interrupt that rain, couldn't deflect that rain from the son.
That's
was he an only child?
I don't know. I don't know. There's no mention of any of the siblings.
I think there must
be. There was a girlfriend in the background.
Yeah.
And he'd had an affair, hadn't he, before this
apparently, yes.
happened?
Yes.
And they split up.
But flying an airplane, a commercial airplane, relies on relationships.
Yes.
With your crew
yes.
on the plane, with a crew on the ground, with the organizational skills of a company.
Yeah.
It's a huge set of relationships. You can't just fly on your own those days.
Yeah.
It's certainly not an Airbus A320, a huge plane.
Yeah. But also, as I was, you know, what sort of struck me was I wonder about the medication that he was on.
Allegedly, he was on some kind of medication, possibly bipolar.
Mm.
Bipolar, in psychological terms, would correspond to Freud's melancholia, which is exactly what happened when the superego is raining down on you. Say all the time, bad, bad, bad.
So maybe he'd failed to take his medication.
We don't know.
It's apocalypse, really, isn't it?
Push and pull.
Yeah.
There is something which pushes from behind, and there is something which pulls from in front. Yes.
Mm.
There is a bit.
So what pulled him then? Yeah, so it was death. Pulled him.
Not even death. It's beyond death. It's an absolute.
It's back to.
Doesn't fit with life, yeah, because death.
Back to the point you were making about. Passage to the act or whatever. He is putting something on scene, and it probably is a mixture between Werther and Ravenel. That's what he's putting on scene. But it's driving him. the scene is driving.
Yeah, it makes me feel really sad. I mean, hearing your analysis of it is fascinating, but I find that you noted the same things that I did that made it really bizarre, that story. And also, I feel something for this man, you know?
Yeah.
I don't think he's...
Could we say that he was lost in the desert of a real?
Yes.
I think it's even beyond that, actually.
The night of the real, I don't know, it's just...
Yeah, the night of the real.
And nobody realised that that was where he was.
Plus, taking with him all the passengers.
Yeah, well, that's what people can't forgive, but I mean, then it wouldn't be apocalypse, would it, so much?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, and
yeah.
It's the social bond, isn't it? All these other people.
When the Valhalla palace and the girls burn down, all the girls are inside the palace, yeah. That's his Valhalla, the plane. But he became his Valhalla.
Oh, God.
It would be really powerful. Hey, that would make a wonderful novel.
And don't forget...
the number of passengers wouldn't have made it.
168 women.
So,
I think there were teenagers, most of them, coming back from some holiday. Yeah. Youngsters. Werther's age.
Yeah.
That Charlotte and Albert were the same age, around the same age, in the very early 20s, 2021. One too much,
yeah.
I remove myself, boom!
Yeah.
And the ground also is the fact that the fiction became a reality. There was identification, and a lot of youngsters went after reading Werther, boom! And the aspect also of the capitalist discourse, because in the old days you had a free crew in the government.
Yeah. Well, also, what about the medics that didn't communicate?
Apparently, yeah. German laws on privacy are very, very strict. They could not. At which point do you, or don't you, communicate when there is a very... where you diagnose a very strong potential of danger and harm to a subject, which would...
I think if someone's a pilot...
It is a very difficult tipping point in psychoanalysis or working with children or whatever. It's a very, very difficult point. If you have knowledge...
Have you been through that?
Do you use it?
I do.
Yeah.
I use it. I can't not. It's an act.
Yeah.
Actually.
Yeah. But
so it depends on each individual, wouldn't it, really?
Well, and then
maybe it's best to give it that.
Each individual doctor seeing this man had no idea how this was going to come together.
No.
I don't think you can make them responsible for that.
No,
one of them would know that the eyes weren't working. Another might know that he was bipolar. Another might know whatever. But none of this information was in the same place at the same time.
And do you think that's a result of the capitalist discourse, or do you think this is just...
I think it's the cock-up theory of life, you know. I mean, of course they should have been talking to each other.
Of course they
should have been talking to the air company. But they weren't.
Well, no one realised how bad it was. It's only in retrospect we got...
Yeah. This is a very tentative hypothesis.
Yeah.
Because I don't have a complete file in my hands.
Oh, but it really fits with me, because, you know, it explains why I felt so moved by that story. You know, and I've somehow felt some kind of sympathy for this man. And I, no one else asked, why do I sympathise?